The following program paid for by Rosenberg Financial Group. Providing live finance advice since 1993, it's time for Your Money with Sherry Goss and Randy Goss. To participate in today's program, call 478-742-0940 with your financial questions and comments. And now, live from the Macon studios of News Talk 940 WMAC, it's Your Money.
Good morning, Middle Georgia, and welcome to Your Money. We are Randy and Sherry Goss with Rosenberg Financial Group. As financial advisors, the main thing that we do is provide retirement planning and advice and manage our clients' investment accounts. So if you're looking for a financial advisor, please contact our office to set up a complimentary consultation. And if you're in the need for insurance products such as long-term care or index or fixed annuities, then we can assist with these as well. Our office number is 478-922-8100, and we have offices in Macon and Warner Robins for your convenience. To find out more about our website, our company, visit our website, retirerelax.com, where you can read a number of special reports and listen to past radio show broadcasts. And you can sign up to receive digital feeds, which provide great information on various subjects in a short video format. We also offer seminars in the community, so if you're a member of a church or community group and you're looking for a guest speaker, please call us and we will kick Sherry out the door to your location pronto. If you'd like to call in today, the number is 478-742-0940, or you can send me an email at randy@rfmoney.com and we'll cover your question in a future broadcast. Good morning, Sherry. How are you feeling?
I'm still relaxed. I'm almost too relaxed.
Well, you better get it in here because we're teaching Sherry how to do plumbing today. She's going to cut pipes and use glue, things she's never done before.
I'm so excited about that.
So make sure you wear your little neoprene gloves or you'll have blue hands for your client meetings next week, which doesn't come off very easy. Okay.
Yeah, he wants to teach me stuff. Whatever. So Cherry Blossom is coming up. Go to cherryblossom.com. Look at the schedule. It's crazy. It's like 3 weeks of stuff to do. I saw at least 10 concerts when I was going through it last night. It's just stuff. They have added stuff to it. So we used to get the grandbaby and try to get her to some of these dog shows and races and all that stuff. They were so crowded we couldn't even hardly see anything. So if you're going to go to an event, show up early so you can actually be in the front row and see what's going on, because the crowds are going to be huge this year.
Well, at least we're going to have her again this time, too, but at least she's big enough to walk the entire time.
Yeah, that helps.
You know, no strollers, nothing. So we just have to keep up with her. That might be the trick.
Right. So the S&P 500 closed down yesterday, almost exactly where it closed on January 3rd. So we are flat for the year. Don't forget to spring your clocks forward Sunday. I wish they'd do away with this daylight savings time.
Me too.
It's so
Why
stupid.
Go through the gyrations for this? It's just a pain.
It messes up our cats.
That is a true statement.
I mean, the cats are already getting up at 4:30, and now they're going to get up at 4:30, and we're going to be sleeping later.
Well, now the spring forward, it usually helps them. It's when we fall back. That's when they still get up at the other time. So there's 6 months of our lives that our alarm clock is set for 6, but the cats come in at 5, and they're getting more rambunctious in the morning, so maybe 4:30 even. So anyway.
Oh, well, anyways. So FDIC, big SVP weekend. Like, we needed one more thing on top of everything else that's going on in the economy.
Right.
The FDIC and state regulators shut down Silicon Valley Bank on Friday. Now the FDIC has the weekend to figure out what comes next. Will there be a quick buyer for SVP? Presumably, insured depositors will regain access to their funds on Monday, but what about uninsured deposits? Some 87.5% of Silicon Valley Bank's $126 billion in deposits as of December 31 exceeded FDIC insurance limits. So that money's just gone.
Not necessarily, but they'll have to. It'll be a lot of litigation that goes behind it.
Late Friday, Roku disclosed that $487 million, or 26% of its cash, is held at SVP, with those deposits largely uninsured. Roku stock fell after hours. Hundreds of companies, including many venture capital and tech startups, have deposits or business ties to Silicon Valley Bank. Tesla CEO Elon Musk tweeted that he is open to the idea of Twitter buying SVP and turning it into a digital bank. Oh. Musk has said he wants to make Twitter a bigger payment player. So that guy is smart. Anyways, when good news is bad news, jobs report, U.S. economy adds 311,000 jobs in February as labor market stays strong. The report came in far above consensus forecasts, suggesting persistent inflationary forces and more pressure on the Federal Reserve to keep cooling the economy aggressively. So if you're a client of ours, this does not affect you whatsoever, so don't even worry about it. From a newsletter we follow, comments regarding Chairman Powell's interview this week. So this is an interview between John Kennedy and another lady and Powell. Republican Senator John Kennedy of Louisiana cited research suggesting that during the last 10 times the U.S. economy had disinflationary periods since the 50s, for every 2% reduction in the inflation rate, unemployment went up by 3.6%. Powell didn't dispute that, so Kennedy did the math. Based on current numbers, unemployment would have to hit 7% to get the consumer price index from its current 6.4 down to 4.4. That's what the record would say, Powell replied. And to get inflation down to 2.2% based on history, Kennedy said the unemployment rate would have to go to 10.6%, right? To which Powell said, I don't think that kind of a number is at all in play. Write that down somewhere for posterity in the event it happens. And note that even after he agreed with the research that led to this conclusion, Powell didn't even want to think about the idea of double-digit unemployment. Kennedy's point is bringing all this up wasn't to make a good quote. He wanted to suggest that Congress should spend less money and stop racking up debt, because the more we help on the fiscal side, the fewer people you're going to have to put out of work, he said to Powell. It could work that way, said the Fed chair. The U.S. national debt came up late in the proceedings. Wyoming Republican Cynthia Loomis asked whether Powell considers the cost of borrowing for the U.S. government when setting rate policy, given the size of our national debt. Congress has racked up a debt totaling around 120% of GDP as of December. Powell said no, and we're not going to consider it. That would be fiscal dominance. If we were constrained in our monetary policy by the budgetary situation of the United States, and we're not, we're clearly not. The path we're on is not sustainable, but the level of debt that we have is sustainable. We don't think about interest costs when we make monetary policy. We think about maximum employment and price stability. Flabbergasted, Loomis asked the natural follow-up. It's your opinion the level of debt we have is sustainable? Powell said it again. Yes, clearly we have the largest economy in the world. We can service this debt. That's not the problem. The problem is that we're on a path where the debt is growing substantially faster than the economy.
That's right.
That's by definition in the long run unsustainable. The way countries have fixed that is with longer-term programs that have bipartisan support that address the actual problem in the budget. That's really the formula. We're not betting on anyone addressing the actual problem in the budget anytime soon, so after all we heard today, the takeaway is this: be ready for more of the same. That means more government spending, more inflation, and higher interest rates for longer and longer. Stocks fell Thursday after jobless claims showed the labor market is still strong, complicating the picture for the Fed's rate path.
Right. But
on the other hand,
the Fed seen on shallower rate path as a way to cool the gains. The Federal Reserve may have less reason to raise interest rates as sharply or as high as earlier thought, after a government report Friday rekindled hopes of easing inflation amid signs that the pandemic-disrupted labor market is normalizing. Though the month's payroll gains of 311,000 exceeded expectations, hiring was concentrated in a narrower range of industries, a sign the economists point to as suggestions that has been an extremely tight labor market is set to ease. That could set the stage for slower growth, lessening price pressures ahead, and reducing the need for the Fed to return to the aggressive rate hikes it used last year to rapidly reach a more restrictive monetary policy. We shall see.
So Biden's plan to avert Medicare funding crisis includes tax hikes on high earners. President Biden's coming budget blueprint will propose extending the solvency of a key Medicare trust fund by at least 25 years, according to the White House, in part by increasing tax rates on people earning more than $400,000 a year.
And, you know, Sherry, when's it going to change and they no longer consider $400,000 to be a high rate wage earner, when they drop it down to, say, $150,000, $200,000?
And here's an issue that no one talks about. your wages depend on where you live.
That's right.
If you live in New York, which is a very expensive place, you make more money, and there's probably a lot of people in New York that are getting paid as a couple, married, filing joint, $400,000 a year. It's not that big of a stretch to do it.
That's
if you
right.
own a business,
mm-hmm.
That includes a lot of people. The plan would raise Medicare taxes to 5% from 3.8% for those top earners and effectively expand the reach of the tax so it applies to business income as well as investments. Here's the thing that he keeps trying to do. He wants to tax your investment accounts.
That's right.
Which is insane. It's not even possible. I mean,
there's no realized gain there. There's no income that's come from that at this point.
It doesn't make wages and self-employment income, which they already tax, double. Mr. Biden would also redirect some existing taxes from the government's general fund to a Medicare fund.
Yep, and you know, Sherry, have you heard the reports validating the outrageous time frame extension of 25 years?
I don't understand the math.
I have not, and all the past attempts to extend the projected life of the program, even just a few years at a time, were far short of 25 years, so I'd love to see how they got those numbers. I hope everyone was listening to what Sherry said a minute ago. This proposal will apply to businesses as well as your investments. The only thing missing from this proposal is a way to curb spending. Also note the part where Mr. Biden will redirect existing taxes from the general fund to Medicare. It reeks. More national debt. Let's be clear about... Let us be clear as a nation the ways to bring rampant government spending under control. Then, with a balanced budget and a reasonable government spending, we would have no need to increase people's taxes. You know, Secretary Yellen, in her 2021 Medicare Trustees Report, provided some incredible Medicare numbers. And Mr. Biden's proposal to fix these issues is, first, a fulfillment of his campaign promise to tax the rich, and second, nothing more than political grandstanding. But here are some numbers from Yellen's report. The annual cash shortfall in 2020 was $495 billion for Medicare. Can you even get your head around that, Sherry?
No.
This is $495.5 billion, more than their annual budget of $829 billion, according to the Medicare trustees. Medicare's cumulative cash shortfall since 1965 is $5.9 trillion. For all but 2 years, the program has had a cash shortfall. Those years were 1966 and 1974, so almost 50 years since they were able to work within their budgets. Next was Medicare's true contribution to the national debt is 28.8%. And you know, the ongoing Medicare status quo is unacceptable, in my opinion. I think yours too, Sherry. Balancing Medicare's annual cash shortfall under the existing system would prove devastating to seniors and require the following reforms. Annual payroll tax increase would need to be increased 32.6%. The annual premium increase needed to balance Medicare Part B would need to be $4,797. That's the increase to the existing premium. And the annual premium increase needed to balance Medicare Part D would need to increase $2,218. So what do you think, Sherry?
So Sarah Flame, spokeswoman for House Budget Committee Republicans, said Mr. Biden's Medicare proposals would hurt economic growth and stifle prescription drug innovation. She said he was attempting to double count these policies as both reducing the deficit and extending the life of the Medicare Trust Fund. The tax increase could either be used to finance Medicare spending or to reduce the deficit, but not both. Mr. Biden is set to release his budget plan on Thursday, which we'll talk about. The budget proposal is unlikely to gain traction in a narrowly divided Congress, but it will nonetheless lay out Mr. Biden's policy priorities ahead of high-stakes spending negotiations with House Republicans, who are calling for deep spending cuts as a condition for raising the debt ceiling. As he prepares to launch his reelection campaign, Mr. Biden is increasingly trying to draw a contrast with Republicans in Congress who are seeking deep cuts to federal programs. In an appeal to older voters, the president has accused some of the GOP of threatening entitlement programs. Republicans have previously proposed raising the Medicare eligibility age, which would be the smartest darn thing to do.
And they're not talking about doing it to the people who are currently on Medicare. They're talking about starting
people.
Back at age 40.
Right. Creating a work requirement for some Medicaid recipients, or making other changes to the programs. But senior GOP lawmakers have said in recent weeks they won't cut Social Security or Medicare. Reserves for Medicare's hospital insurance fund are currently forecast to run out in 2028, at which point the program would be able to pay only about 90% of hospital coverage. The White House estimated that this its plan would extend the solvency of the fund into the 2050s, which that's not right. Under current law for Medicare taxes, which come on top of regular income taxes, most employers and workers each pay 1.45% payroll tax for a total of 2.9%. Self-employed people pay taxes on both sides. Top earners, individuals making more than $200,000 and married couples making over $250,000, pay an additional 0.9% on money above those thresholds for a total of 3.8%. In addition, a parallel 3.8% tax applies to net investment income for that same top group. That doesn't, however, create a uniform 3.8% tax on income. Active business income, like the profits of a closely held manufacturer, isn't subject to the payroll tax or to the investment income tax.
You know, Sherry, I find it interesting that the Wall Street Journal reported that the President and the First Lady, Jill Biden, used that technique, likely saving hundreds of thousands of dollars in taxes on the income that they earned from speeches and books after his term as a vice president ending. And that was in their publicly disclosed tax documents.
Right. Obama's did the same. They all do the same.
But it's just the double standard that I think everyone that's not in D.C.
They get away with it and they want to punish everybody else. It's the old double standard that is a hallmark of our D.C. leaders. He also proposed expanding the 3.8% tax before so that it would apply to all those types of income. But Democrats have been unable to move that idea through Congress. What's new in this week's proposal is the call to raise the top rate to 5% for those taxes. Unlike Social Security taxes, these taxes don't have an income cap and effectively create a new top tax bracket. If Mr. Biden again proposes raising the top marginal income tax to 39.6 from 37, he would be seeking a combined top federal tax rate of 44.6%, higher than at any point since the mid-80s. If that becomes law, the combined marginal tax rate on top earners would exceed 50% in many states.
Thank you, President Biden. Anyway, let's talk about some of the president's tax increases. The press is reporting that President Biden's 2024 budget proposal, which was released, as we said, Thursday, would cut the deficit by $3 trillion over 10 years. The plan raises taxes.
Which is nothing.
Right.
We were in 31 point whatever trillion.
How about let's make it, I don't know.
The interest one, that won't even cover the interest on the debt.
That's right. The plan raises taxes by nearly $4.7 trillion and would increase revenue and spending to unprecedented plateaus as a share of the economy. The president's $6.89 trillion proposal is a political document that sets up his reelection campaign. Its spending and tax proposals were rejected in the last Congress under Democratic majorities and had no chance of passing the GOP House. But the budget shows where Mr. Biden wants to take the country if he wins a second term. And I'm sure Bernie Sanders is very pleased. So let's highlight a few of the key tax proposals. Start with the tax increases that far exceed even those that passed last year in the Inflation Reduction Act. A new wealth tax. The budget exhumes the wealth tax that Senate Democrats proposed to pay for the president's Build Back Better plan. It proposes a 25% minimum tax on the full income of Americans with more than $100 million in wealth, which means that the taxing increase in the value of assets even if no income is earned.
You can't tax assets.
I know.
This is so stupid.
It's been proven that it won't work. Personal income and capital gains tax hikes. Mr. Biden wants to tax capital gains at the same rate as ordinary income for those making more than $1 million. This would effectively double the 20% tax rate on capital gains, since he also wants to raise the top rate on personal income over $400,000 to 39.6% from 37%. But wait, it's worse. There's a surtax on the surtax. The budget extends the 3.8 surtax currently applied on investment income of couples making more than $250,000 to business income. It also raises this rate and the top Medicare payroll tax on wages to 5% for those earning more than $400,000. This 44.6 top marginal rate would hit businesses, investments, and wage income.
Add state taxes, and many high earners would pay a combined top rate of more than 55%. This is higher than the UK, Germany, Spain, and even Sweden. And we don't have free health care.
Right.
Maybe we should move to Sweden.
He's just in a race to get to the top tax bracket in the world, you know. Capital gains are taxed at lower rates than wage income, in part because they are eroded by inflation and higher rates discourage people from selling stocks and realizing income. Even liberal economists agree that there are diminishing returns on capital gains taxes once the rate exceeds 28%. Mr. Biden's increases could reduce revenue for the Treasury as well. Corporate tax rate increases. The budget raises the corporate income rate from 28% to from 21, and the maximum rate on the foreign earnings of U.S. multinationals is basically doubled to 21%. This comes on top of the IRA's new 15% minimum tax on book income for corporations with more than $1 billion profits. All of this will raise the cost of investing and the federal corporate rate well above 28% for many companies and higher than before the 2017 tax reform that finally ended the flight of U.S. companies overseas. Add the average state corporate rate of 6%, and the U.S. companies will be at a large global disadvantage. 4% stocks buyback tax. Mr. Biden didn't waste any time adding to the IRA's 1% tax on corporate stock buybacks, quadrupling it a year later. The higher rate will interfere with business decisions on where it can invest their capital with damaging impacts on growth. All of these increases are projected to raise revenue as a share of the GDP to a higher level of 20.1% of the GDP in 2023, which is far above the 2033, which is far above the 50-year average of 17.4. One reason the tax share isn't even higher is because the tax hikes would be offset by spending increases via the tax code, such as a $3,600 refundable child tax credit, and making the IRA's sweetened Affordable Care Act premium subsidies permanent. Meanwhile, spending would climb to 25.2% of GDP, compared to the 50-year average of 21%. That owing to rising interest costs on the federal debt and Mr. Biden's proposal for a cavalcade of entitlements such as universal pre-K, child care, paid family leave,
free
and housing.
Free child care.
Yep.
Even
with the tax deficits over the next decade totaling $17.4 trillion, and debt held by the public as a share of the GDP would rise to 109.8% in 2033 from 97% last year. Mr. Biden's budget is a recipe for an economically and militarily weaker America, but at least he's warning the voters of his intention, unlike in 2020.
So I emailed, I'm sorry that we're just blowing
that was a lot of numbers.
Stuff, and we're just kind of frustrated about this entire situation, which you can probably tell. So I emailed our CPA about all of this and said, "What the heck do you think? I mean, what's this going to do to everybody? And how are you going to advise people that make money to get around this?" And his response was, "I've been really busy doing tax returns, so I haven't really had time to look at this because he's swamped." He said, "But with the Republicans in the House, I think Calvin Coolidge said it best. If you see 10 troubles coming down the road, you can be sure that 9 will run into the ditch before they reach you. Politicians are like farmers." Sorry, I'm not trying to disparage farmers. "Politicians plant seeds, and the next politician waters the seeds, and they start to grow, and it continues." So we need to be very careful who we elect in this next presidential election, that they want to reverse this trend. We cannot keep going into debt as a country. We're going to end up like Venezuela.
Right.
I mean, seriously, stupid. Anyways, okay. So, fear over Social Security's future leads some to claim retirement benefits early. And I do see this. Some Americans are claiming Social Security years before full retirement age out of fear their benefits will be cut once the program runs short on cash. They say they want to get as much in benefits as they can before 2034 when it can't pay full benefits. That is when, skip that. Most expect Congress will prevent a precipitous drop in benefits. It is unclear how many retirees take Social Security early because of anxiety over finances, though a quarter of men and 27% of women filed for benefits in 2021 when they turned 62. So I talk to people about Social Security when we meet clients, prospects. I mean, I talk about this with everybody because you have to be careful how you apply. So let's say you have a husband and wife in my office. The husband worked. The wife was a stay-at-home mom. What I would typically advise them is that he wait until 70 to max out his benefit, and then she claims half of his as long as she's age eligible to get that. If she's under full retirement age, her benefits reduced. It'd be half of his, but reduced. So you have to really figure this out and make a plan. But if both husband and wife have great earnings records, I suggest they take the benefits on their own records, especially as if they can live on one benefit when the other spouse passes, because that needs to be part of the equation. If one of you gets sick and dies, how's the other one going to fare? I mean, how's this going to work?
Yep.
So one spouse has a pension with no survivor benefits. Wait to take Social Security, get the spouse that doesn't have a pension the highest benefit, and if the spouse with the pension passes first, the other spouse can claim their higher Social Security. So if you have any questions about this, we have a special report on our website that you can use to help you make the best decision. Just go to retireatrelax.com, click on special reports, and there's you'll scroll down and you'll see the Social Security report that explains all of this, and I update it every year.
Yep. Good job.
So halftime.
All right. That's right.
Guys, it's flying.
I know. You've been listening to Randy and Sherry Goss with Your Money with Rosenberg Financial Group. If you'd like to call in today and contribute to the show, the number is 478-742-0940. Rosenberg Financial Group has offices in Macon and Warner Robins, and you can learn more about us by visiting our website, retirerelax.com. We do offer complimentary consultations, and setting up an appointment is easy. Just call the office at 478-922-8100. And we offer seminars to the community, so if you're looking for a guest speaker, please give us a call to discuss what topics you'd like to cover. And that was it.
Okay.
All right. So let's talk about investors and options. All right. Not long ago, trading in American stock options was limited mainly to the professionals, investors. Option contracts that provide the right to buy or sell a security at a specific price over a fixed time period. They can deliver big payouts if stock moves in the desired direction and expire worthless otherwise. Sophisticated buyers use options to hedge against risk, generate income as a form of leverage. However, options can also be used to gamble. Interest in the American options has grown rapidly since the COVID-19 pandemic began. In early 2020, the number of options traded per year rose from 20 million to 30 million. It surged again to 40 million in early 2021. When trading erupted in the meme stocks such as GameStop, an enthusiast flocked to options to magnify their bets. Trading has reached a record high this year. The average in February was 45 million, and on February 2nd, 68 million contracts changed hands. Overall, the most heavily traded options are puts, and that's a bet a security price will fall on market indices, which can be used to limit risk. Most of these contracts are probably held by institutional investors. Retail traders, though, seem to be using options mainly to speculate. In 2020 and 2021, they bought twice as many calls. That's the bet that the price will rise. And such investors whose shares of the overall stock trading in America has doubled since 2019, now accounting for 48% of trading volume in options, according to a forthcoming paper in the Journal of Finance published by the London School of Business. Moreover, rather than trading options for the last options that last for weeks, months, or years, buyers are now piling into zero-day expiration.
Which is insane.
ODTE contracts. These options, which expire the day that they are bought and yield windfalls if the price moves sharply that day, they become more widely available in 2022 after exchanges increase the number of trading days on which they are available. As meme stock mania has faded, ODTE options, mainly written on the market-wide indices, have become the new fad. Daily trading of ODTE contracts recently reached a record notional value of $1 trillion, which is just insane. This according to Options Metric, a data provider. They now account for more than half of the trading options on the S&P 500 index, up from a quarter in 2019.
Some market analysts have warned that ODTE options pose a systemic risk. In theory, if the investors selling them do not hold positions in the securities underlying these contracts, an abrupt intraday price change could force them to trade vast quantities of these assets simultaneously. Even if options do not threaten markets as a whole, they clearly represent a siren song for retail investors. Despite the rise in share prices since early 2020, traders have treated stock markets like a casino, they have on average fared about as well as a typical slot machine player. The Journal of Finance authors estimate between November 2019 and June of 2021, retail investors collectively lost $2.1 billion because they're betting.
They don't know what they're doing.
This is stupid.
Right.
Why is this legal?
Right. The proceeds from these traders' losses accrue to both counterparties, that's the person selling the options, and to the middlemen. According to a working paper by Thomas Ernst of the University of Maryland and Carnegie Mellon, bid-ask spreads, that's the gap between the market makers' listed buys and sell prices for a given security, are wider for options than for stocks. To collect such spreads, market makers pay brokers twice as much for the privilege of executing trades and options as for stocks. As a result, in 2022, retail brokers made $2 billion from options trading, a small but fast-growing share of their profits. Just like casinos and options trading, the house always wins.
They get paid regardless.
And you know, Sherry, a lot of times what you're seeing is, and we do talk to people who come in and they tell us what they're doing. These are like people who just, they're not clients. Mm-hmm. They come in and say, hey, I want to do options, or I want to do other stuff that's like on the leading edge of popularity, right? But they don't know what they're doing. They just want to start throwing their money at something and hoping to learn it on the fly.
Get rich quick.
It's that's the mentality. Yes,
yes,
it is. Anyway.
So imagine seeing your job position on LinkedIn and it pays $32K to $90K more than you make.
That would be horrible.
Yeah. So picture this. You're scrolling through LinkedIn and notice a job posting for the same role you're doing now as a contractor. And the job post says it pays $32,000 to $90,000 more. I just repeated that. That's apparently what happened to Kimberly Smith. I had to change her name because I couldn't pronounce her real name. User Experience UX.
I'm sure there's a Kimberly Smith out there with the same problem.
Right? A User Experience UX writer in New York City who's been working at Citibank as a contractor through the UK-based IT services and consulting company Photon for the past 6 months. New York salary transparency laws dictate that employers must provide the salary range for an open position, and that's how Kimberly, who earns $85,000 a year, in her role as a contract worker, learned that Citi was offering $117 to $175 a year for the same staff position, doing the same job she's doing as a contractor. It was an unpleasant surprise. She says, I was just really upset that the pay discrepancy was so high. She's 25, told MarketWatch over email. But I was also really grateful that salary transparency laws allowed me to see that information because it showed me that I wasn't really being valued. Okay? This is a thing. It should be noted that the Citi position advertised on LinkedIn is for a full-time UX copywriter with 5 to 8 years of experience.
Mm-hmm.
She's 25.
Yep.
But she thinks she should get paid the same as somebody that's been doing her job for 8 years.
But we see that in a lot of
yes.
young people that we meet and watch, that they want the same thing mom and dad's got now.
Now.
Without having to work for it.
It just drives me crazy. Kimberly said she had been trying to negotiate a pay raise for some time before, after reaching what UX writers make in New York City and realizing there was not a single UX writer job that listed their pay range anything close to what I'm making now. So she went to management and complained, and then she went out, I'm going to skip through some of this stuff, and then she vented her frustration in a Twitter thread late Tuesday afternoon. My company just listed a LinkedIn job posting for what I'm currently doing, and now thanks to salary transparency laws, I see they intend to pay this person $32,000 to $90,000 more than they pay me, so I applied. And her experience struck a chord with people on Twitter, so everybody piled in on it.
Mm-hmm.
So here's the problem. You think you deserve something you haven't earned. You can't bypass the rules. If they need 8 years of experience for you to grow, this is not showing that you've grown at all.
Well, here's the other side to it. You know, let's just say you jump on the desk of your supervisor and you're screaming and yelling that you want this new higher pay. And they go, okay, we'll give it to you. And then you can't perform because you don't have the skills requisite to do that job.
Then you get fired.
And then you get fired. How's that going to look in your resume?
This is such a trend. I'm seeing this all over the place of people feeling like you should have everything now. You're 25 and you should be head of whatever because you think you're so smart. And a lot of it's also driven by how much student loan debt you're in. Because they think, because I've gone to school and I have $120,000 of student loan debt, I deserve to be paid more. That's not how the world works.
Nope.
So I don't know where she's going to end up. Hopefully she doesn't get fired. for posting all this stuff online.
She'll probably end up as the boss.
Well, good luck with that.
Right, yeah.
Anyways.
Anyway, low-wage workers climb the earnings ladder. When COVID struck, economists worried that the poor workers might suffer a permanent setback. With the broad job losses the pandemic set off concentrated in low-wage industries, the earnings gap between the rich and the poor seemed likely to only widen. It has narrowed instead, with wage growth amongst low-paid and less educated workers outstripping wage growth among the better-paid and more highly educated. In a paper posted to the National Bureau of Economic Research website on Monday, they explored how this came about. Their findings suggest that even as the pandemic phase, competition for wage workers will be more intense than before the pandemic, and that could lead to further reductions in income inequality, raise labor costs at firms that employ wage workers, and reshape the U.S. business landscape. The outsized wage gains that have accrued to lower income and less educated workers since the pandemic began are well documented. For example, the Labor Department data shows that the worker at the upper limit of the bottom 10% by income were 22.3% higher than in the fourth quarter of 2019, outpacing the 15.7% gain in consumer prices over the same period by the Labor Department's inflation measures. But for a worker at the 90th percentile, earnings grew 13.3%. The data further shows median weekly earnings for workers with just a high school diploma rose 17.1% over the same period, while workers with at least a bachelor's degree grew just 11.9%. That's a big spread there. But poorer workers aren't doing uniformly better. Analyzing microdata from the Labor Department, economists find that a number of workers with high school education or less, and those under 40, who have seen the most significant wage gains, that appears to be driven by young workers' higher tendency to switch jobs. Older, less educated workers who stayed in the same job through the pandemic aren't keeping ahead of inflation like the young and the footloose. And I will tell you, to me, this is like a professor on test prep day, and he's stomping his foot when he says certain things. And the moral of that story is, if you want more pay, you can continue looking around right now. Of course, that is coming to an end, and we're seeing the signs that the job hopping is not going to be as lucrative as it has been. So if you're stuck in the same place, your purchasing power is getting eroded. Part of what might have driven the wage gains in that onset of the pandemic unstuck many less educated workers from jobs that paid worse than they might have gotten elsewhere. The job losses among workers at age 25 and older with a high school education or less were extreme, with employment levels falling more than one-fifth from February 2020 through April 2020. As a reminder,
yeah, my client who got unemployment for 16 months plus three stimulus checks.
Right.
While she was working. So these people that are complaining about this, and they're talking about these low wage workers, they got other benefits that we never got.
That's true.
Got free money, and they also qualify for other government benefits.
That's true.
So they're leaving all of that out of this equation. So a lot of people don't want to make more money, because if they do, they're going to lose benefits.
Well, those,
it's
those
a game.
Are the ones, those are the ones who have stuck in their current job and not job hop to try to find
more money.
Some more money. And when the job market came roaring back, many of these workers didn't simply go back to their old jobs, like you're insinuating there, but to ones with higher pay. Helping the process, several rounds of relief payments, as you said, were giving them the wherewithal to go job shopping. So it's a good thing to know if you're in a position and you think that you might can make more pay somewhere else. Get out there and do some investigation. I mean, that's the moral of the story.
So Mr. Autor doesn't expect the fading of some of the pandemic's effects on the economy to unravel the gains made by less educated workers. For instance, a dishwasher who landed a better-paying warehouse job but then goes back to being a dishwasher might be a better-paid dishwasher than before. So I was a dishwasher at the age of 15, and that's a really crappy job.
I was too, and yes, it is.
My hands were raw by the end of every day. My grandmother was worried about my hands because they were red all the time because of being in that boiling water, because I had to shove the stuff through that washer thing,
right, yeah,
and then touch all those hot plates. I was thankful to become a server after that.
Right. Moved up, didn't you? Anyway, hey, this last week I got a call from a brilliant client from Virginia who is excited about this next story. Universal Hydrogen successfully completes first flight of a hydrogen regional airliner. And on Tuesday, the company Universal Hydrogen completed its first flight of a hydrogen regional airliner, and they flew a 40-passenger airliner using hydrogen fuel cell propulsion. The airplane, named Lightning McLean, flew from Grant County International Airport in Oregon for 15 minutes and reached an altitude of 3,500 feet. The flight conducted under the FAA Special Airworthiness Certificate was the first in a two-year flight test campaign expected to culminate in 2025 with entry into the passenger service. The company has a rapid growing order of on the books today, totaling 247 aircraft conversions from 16 customers worldwide, totaling over $1 billion in conversion backlog and over $2 billion in fuel services over the 10 years of operation. According to Universal Hydrogen, this is scalable to large aircraft if it is successful. If it is successful, it will go down in the history books as the true start to decarbonization of the global airline industry. The airplanes are converted to hydrogen using the aftermarket retrofit conversion kits, tackling the existing fleet rather than developing a new brand of
airplanes.
Yes, it is. And hydrogen refueling uses modular capsules capable of existing freight networks.
Compatible
with existing freight networks and airport cargo handling equipment, making every airport in the world instantly hydrogen ready. Sherry, I think this is fantastic, and we're seeing a massive leap in technology every day, it seems like.
Right.
And this is just another great example of it. So
I didn't know where to plug this in. This doesn't really fit anywhere in this whole radio show, but I have to tell you guys, I had a call, an email to call a client this week. So I call them, and AT&T Smart Call Blocker answers the phone. It's free, so it says, if this is a friend or family member, press the pound key. And so I press the pound key, then it lets me through, and the phone rings, and then the client answers the phone.
So stopping robocalls.
Yeah, because if you're a robocaller, you can't press the pound key. You're just calling and expecting people to answer. And she said, I said, this is amazing because this must block a bunch of garbage calls. And she said, it's absolutely fantastic, and it was free.
Is this only AT&T?
No. You can go to Smart Call Blocker, and you can see how to get it for other phone systems. But hers was AT&T, and it came free with her phone. And she said it has saved them so many garbage calls.
Absolutely.
They absolutely love this. And I said, I didn't mind it. I just had to press pound, and then I got through to you. So what's the big deal?
Right.
But anyways, I'm glad they have it because it's especially helpful for people with dementia as they are targeted for scams. And so if you have a family member that has a home phone, see if you can download Smart Call Blocker to keep this garbage from going through to them and just save them a whole lot of grief.
Yeah, that's a great tool.
So three inventions to help us live better longer from the Peter Diamandis, who I love. Peter Diamandis' website, check him out. A headset to boost vision. The risk of developing eye conditions increases with age, according to the National Institute on Aging, but wearable devices could help diagnose vision problems and make up for waning eyesight. Iris Vision, a California-based startup, worked with Samsung to design a 4,000.
Right.
Virtual reality headset that it says can help restore vision for patients suffering from conditions such as macular degeneration, which I have a bunch of people that are going through that I need to bring this up. The headset includes a Samsung Galaxy smartphone that uses software to beam images captured by its camera into still functioning areas of the retina. This allows the brain to compose a full picture. Iris Vision says, users have the option to zoom in and out using a button or voice commands. Primary care doctors could prescribe the apparatus to patients at risk of developing eye conditions and have them do weekly visual field, contrast sensitivity, and color tests, all of which can be done on the headset. As part of a commercial pilot, patients at 50 healthcare practices in New York City can use the service to conduct such tests. So I need to keep this on the radar for my clients.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
And then there's a spoon that recreates saltiness. People's ability to taste starts to decrease around age 60. Among the elderly, some medicines can further dull the senses, according to a research published in the Nutrients Journal last year. In the future, an aging population could rely on smart utensils to improve their sensory experiences. A professor of spatial computing at the University of Maine received $50,000 from the National Science Foundation as part of a grant and to develop a spoon that artificially juices up the perception of saltiness. A tiny module affixed to the handle sends a faint electric current to two electrodes on the utensil's back. When the tongue touches the electrodes, a harmless electric signal stimulates the taste buds into perceiving salt, regardless of whether the condiment can actually be found in a meal. The intensity of the electric current can be adjusted via a smartphone app to reach the desired level. The spoon could be used in nursing homes where employees could help residents calibrate it, and he expected it will be commercialized within 5 years.
It's cool. A big deal because I have people with dementia clients. I have clients who are getting older. They're losing weight because they just don't want to eat because food doesn't taste to them.
Yeah.
It's like cardboard.
That's right.
And COVID has made it even worse because a lot of people that went through COVID lost all their sense of taste or smell, and so they just don't want to eat anything. Yep. So,
and this would be good for like our friend at the lake who puts salt on salt, you know.
Yeah, that's funny. So third one is a hearing aid for health. Loss of hearing is prevalent among people over age 70, research shows. Hearing aids, once obtrusive and meant to fulfill one task, amplifying sounds, are now getting smaller and packing in new technologies and functions. Companies such as Whisper and Starkey are outfitting devices with artificial intelligence-powered software they say makes them better at turning down background noise and amping up speech in busy environments, which scientists say are challenging for people with hearing impairment. Hearing aids could also one day double as digital assistants, connecting with smart glasses and whispering the names of meeting participants to a wearer, for instance. I don't need that.
A lot of people need that.
Really?
How many people don't remember the names of the people they just met?
Me.
Oh, well, then you could have those glasses and your virtual assistant.
I see people in Kroger, and I'm like,
Sherry is Bob. His name's Bob.
I'd have to have photos of everybody in my glasses. Anyways, listening devices could soon monitor biomarkers such as heart rate, body temperature, and blood oxygen saturation. Starkey sells hearing aids that already track steps and can detect falls using accelerometers. Within the next few years, hearing devices could alert a patient's doctor or emergency services that she is experiencing a medical crisis such as pulmonary embolism. Using AI to analyze the trove of data provided by smarter devices could help turn them into diagnostic tools. So all this data is going to get pouring into the doctor. How's the doctor going to have time to look at all this stuff that comes off your smartwatch, your hearing aids, your glasses? I mean, how are they going to...
He'll have AI that condenses everything into...
A paragraph?
A paragraph says, it's Bob, and he's sick.
I mean, they can't even keep up with what they're doing as they are now.
Right.
Anyway.
Let's talk about something that's really important, and that would be being on the same page with your spouse when you retire. When one spouse is fearful of spending in retirement, even when there's enough money, it can make a life a lot less enjoyable for both in retirement. The first year in retirement is often the most difficult, but it can also be the most crucial in setting the stage for how you'll feel the years ahead, both financially and psychologically. And this needs to occur long before you get to retirement. Steve Yoder, 65 years old and a longtime Wall Street Journal editor, recently joined his wife, Karen, 66.
That's really young to retire.
I know. They probably went ahead and took Social Security, too. The Wall Street Journal has a monthly column called Retirement Rookies, where the Yoders write about some of the issues that they are dealing with in that first year, offering their different perspectives on what can be a confusing transition. Karen says there's trouble brewing in her kitchen. It's in the cabinet, she says. Those cabinets were in the house when they bought it 34 years ago. And she describes the cabinets, and they're like the 1980 oak panels that haven't stood the test of the time. She's ready to replace them.
You just paint them.
Right. She's ready to replace them now that they are both retired and will be spending more time in that room. Her husband, Steve, says they can't afford it now that they're on a fixed income. He says it's not like they don't have the funds. He believes that there is more pressing projects, such as electrical upgrades and roofing work. In Steve's mind, buying tools, think a welder and a miter saw, to fix things is acceptable. But, you know, he could rent. I mean, that would be a lot less expensive than going out and buying tools that just sit in his probably shed and for years. But Cosmetic changes, he doesn't like those so much. But the cabinet conflict goes beyond the kitchen. Karen says it's really about Steve's irrational fear of running out of money. These types of conversations are not uncommon, even if both people are on the same page about money. But with irrational fears, it can really tarnish some of the enjoyment of retirement. Karen and Steve were looking forward to a leisurely train trip to see Steve's parents in Iowa. When they had to change their tickets, Steve cast a dark shadow over the trip by worrying about the extra $300 the revision would cost. And just before New Year's, they agreed to start giving more money to charities. And once they started donating more to the charities, Steve started wondering whether they should hold back on increasing giving until they were sure that their financial plan would work. Karen senses Steve is quietly doubting about spending some travel and that they were planning, even though this was one of the main things that they had agreed would be a priority in their retired years. You know, I get it. Some people worry about it more than others. My sister, who is also named Karen, says she frets about running out of money in retirement. You know, it's hard to break the cycle of the non-lean years, and that's the years with dual income, the big house, eating out all the time, trips, and so on. Many Americans have very real worries about running out of money. Rest assured, financial security is a blessing that we don't take lightly for ourselves and for those that we are blessed to call clients and the others who come in for advice. We are not spendthrifts, but we still have two incomes and a nice lifestyle. We have inexpensive hobbies. Well, at least you do, Sherry. But we...
Books.
Both understand that with retirement will come change. This change will be more severe for some and less so for others. These others are the ones who have lived modestly based on their income and have invested for their future in their retired years.
See, it doesn't say what they're invested in.
I know.
It doesn't say if they're in a bank account or if they're in the stock market and down 30. I saw a client last week, a client prospect, came in to see me. They're down 30% in the market.
Yeah.
Because of the fund that they're in.
Yeah.
And so it depends on all of those factors. It depends on your health. Are you going to be taking care of an aging parent? Do you have kids that are still in and out of rehab? I mean, you got a lot of factors here that aren't included in this article that feed into this whole thing.
That you're absolutely correct. But and I think the point is, you know, everyone really should have a good financial advisor and someone that can be on speed dial who actually picks up the phone when you call or at least gives you a call back in a reasonable time frame. This person can help guide you through all of those little hazards of retirement well before you get to retirement. So, you know, they can talk about things that you have just never even thought of, like you just mentioned, an aging parent or having to make adjustments to your own home.
Taking care of your grandkids.
Yes. I mean, there's so many things. But anyway, you don't want to wait until you're 2 years out of retirement to start thinking like this. You want to start thinking about this on the 10-year plan or longer even.
So go to our website, retirerelax.com, mm-hmm. and download the special report, Can I Afford to Retire? And that report will walk you through exactly what I do in an appointment. If you were to come to me, I'm going to assess your income, your assets, and your debt, and I'm going to figure out how likely are you to be successful in retirement. And then I'm going to look at your investment account, and I'm going to assess that as well. And so on the very back of the special report is a spending tracker, and this is critical. Before you retire, you must track your spending for a solid month and see exactly where your money is going and how much you're spending, because the problem is today people use a credit card and a debit card everywhere, so you have no mental understanding of what you're actually spending.
And in my opinion, this is not a one-and-done kind of deal either. You should do this on
every
an annual
year,
basis.
Every January.
Absolutely.
But anyways, if you would go to retirerelax.com, Can I Afford to Retire, go through all of it, work through it, do the spending tracker for a month. If you want to, come and see me and talk through it. It doesn't cost you anything. Consultations are free. But you have to do the homework.
Yep.
You can't just check out. And that's what I feel like the problem is with this couple. They're not on the same page at all. It's like they haven't looked at the math. And he's freaked out, and she's not. But they're not talking about numbers.
Well, I was paraphrasing a lot of articles, and they do say that they have plenty of income. He's just worried that he's going to live longer and not have money.
Which is a problem. It's possible.
It's possible. I mean, that's the kind of thing that you talk with people about when they come in. It's real important, as I said before, to have a financial advisor that you can rely on, someone who's going to cover all of these topics with you.
Yes.
If you'd like to come in for a consultation, come see us. Just call our office, 478-922-8100, and we will get you on the calendar.
But yeah, this article is good, but it misses a lot of pieces. So
it was the 30,000 foot view.
Yes, so that's a good description.
Yep.
All right.
Anyway,
I think we're down to the last minute.
We're down to the last minute. All right. So anyway, thanks for listening to the show today, guys. We really do appreciate it. And you've been listening to Your Money, which is produced by Rosenberg Financial Group. As financial advisors, the main thing that we do is provide retirement planning and advice and manage our clients' investment accounts. So if you're looking for a financial advisor, please contact our office to set up a complimentary consultation. Our office number is 478-922-8100, and you can learn more about us by visiting our website, retirerelax.com. And if you have questions or a topic you'd like for us to cover in the next week broadcast, please email me, randy@rfmoney.com, and we will look forward to connecting with you and hopefully covering that topic in the coming weeks.
So, and these broadcasts are also on our website.
That's right.
So if you want to go back and listen to past shows, you can. Check out the special reports. Sorry I beat the drum on this one, but the Life Book is absolutely free.
It's great.
You can print out the pages and get all of your affairs in order. You can also go to Emory Law. Search Emory Law, LAWPOA, free, and you will go to the Emory Law website where you can get a free power of attorney and a free advance directive, fillable forms, and all you have to do is take the power of attorney to the bank and have them notarize it for you, and it's legal. It's an incredible, incredible deal. Have a great week.
Great weekend.
Securities and investment advisory services offered through Royal Alliance Associates Incorporated, member FINRA SIPC. Royal Alliance Associates Incorporated is separately owned, and other entities and or marketing names, products or services referenced here are independent of Royal Alliance Associates Incorporated. The views expressed are not necessarily the opinion of Royal Alliance Associates Incorporated. Investing is subject to risk, including loss of principal invested. No strategy can assure a profit against loss. Rosenberg Financial Group is located at 2517 Moody Road, Warner Robins, Georgia, 31088, and can be reached at 478-922-8100.